Hey everyone, and welcome to day 10 of learning Illustrator. And to start with, let's see what all we learned in day 9. So in day 9, we learned about transform tools, which are rotate, reflect, scale and shear. And then we saw few options in transform panel. And then we saw about transform options, which we can access by right clicking on our shape to get all these options. Okay, so in day 10, that is today, we are going to learn about swatches. Today is all about coloring actually. So first of all, we'll learn about swatches and swatch panels. Then we'll learn about gradient. Under that, we will cover gradient tool and gradient panel. Then we will see strokes and stroke panel. Then we are going to cover width tool. And finally, we'll finish our chapter with eyedropper tool. So I think you are ready and let's get started. This time, instead of creating a new file, I'm opening a previous example, which is fillexample.ai. So just click on it and open it. You might be able to download this example from the course content. So I will provide this example to you for demo use also. And here I have this example and I have created this world map, which is a group actually. And inside this, there are these countries which are independent shapes. And then we have this outline, so which you can drag or even you can delete if you want these white shapes only. So yeah, you have the freedom to modify this example the way you want. So let me just quickly go through the structure of this one. So here I have created the layer. The layer name is map layer. And when you open this layer, you get this group name, which is map group. So now you will be able to understand what is actually happening in this file. And when you open this group, you have all the shapes which are actually making the map. So like all these outlines are the country shapes you have over here. Okay, so let us close the layer panel. Now the first thing we are going to learn today is swatches. So it comes under coloring, and to open the panel you can go to window and click on swatches from here, or you can, if it's already available in your panel bar, you can click on this checkboxes. There is this checkbox icon and you can click on this, so it will open this web panel. Here you can see you have a few various colors, and then you have few gradients also, these three gradients, and then you have two pattern fills. So it contains quite a few options over here, and then you have these two folders. So when you click on this folder, you can select the entire folder. You have the freedom to click and drag any of these things to rearrange them. I don't know, will it go above all these colors? No, it won't go. So again, the colors, you have the freedom to click on any of this color and rearrange them the way you want. So I'll just keep it the way it was. And how it works is, you click on any of the shape and you click on the color, so it will pick that color for you, and it will act, it will automatically fill the color inside the shape. Okay, so let us see how will it work. So in this example, we are I'm planning to fill color in all these countries, and the rule for that is no consecutive two countries or any country which is which have their border same shall not have same color. So what I mean to say by that is, let's say if I take India as my first country and I fill red inside it. Oh, one more thing, you want to make sure that you have your fill active instead of the outline. Otherwise, when you have your outline active and you go to swatches and select a color, so you can see it's filling the outline. So that's what I don't want. So I will select fill as my active one, and now I'm going to fill red inside this shape. Okay, so now let's say there are few countries which are sharing the same border of India. Let's say this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, and this one. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. These six countries, out of the six countries, no one should have red in them, because then it will be like two consecutive countries sharing the same color. So yeah, let's begin then. So In this country, we can fill orange, and here when we go, we can have our yellow color. Here we can go with green. Again, here we can go with here we can again go with orange, because not here itself, we can go with orange. And here also we can fill orange or yellow, or no, I think orange is fine here. Here also we can do the same thing, and here also we can have the orange fill. Now you can see that we have managed to fill these many countries with only three colors. So that's a thumb rule we are going to use. And to fill a color inside a shape is really simple. You just select a shape, and then you can click on any of the color in the swatch panel to fill the color inside it. So yeah, I can select red for this one because it is not attached to this country. And similarly here I have yellow and orange already, and red also. So I have to select my fourth color this time. So I'm selecting the green. This time it is attached to yellow and green. So I think I can go with red one. Yeah, that looks good. Here I have red, green and red attached to this country. So maybe orange will do. Okay. Here also I can go with yellow, and here I can go with red again. So let's see this part, how we are going to fill this one also. So select this map and fill red inside this. Select this one, this small thing, and again I cannot fill red, orange or yellow in it. So all these three colors are blocked. Now we have to go with green this time. Here we have all these four colors, or actually here we have this red, orange is disconnected this time, so we can go with orange. Here we can go with yellow. Here we can go with, I think orange again. Yes, orange. Here red, yellow. Here again red. Yeah, orange. No, we cannot fill orange because it is connected over here. So if you see now, orange, yellow, red and yellow, so these three colors has already been used. So we have to go with the fourth one, which is green. And similarly here also we can go with red this time. So that's how it works. And you can see now it has bring a life to this map compared to this white colored map, which was previously it was looking that like this. So you can see what difference it makes when you fill color inside this. So let's fill this entire region and we'll see how much difference it brings. And I'm gonna fast forward the video right now so it don't take much of your time. Now for the small islands, what you can do is select all of them together and have a single fill in them. So like these three islands, this one, this one, this one, we can actually select all of them together and fill red color inside it. So to select multiple objects, just click on one single object and then press shift and keep selecting other objects. And when you have all these objects selected, you can click one of the color you want to fill and it will fill in all those shapes you have selected. Now here you can see some of the parts are left. So what I'm going to do is press Ctrl Y, and you can see all these shapes. Actually there are shapes here and there is no fill in it. I accidentally left them. So it is supposed to be colored in black. So I'm going to select all these borders, all these small parts which I left. And once selected, I'm using the Shift key to select multiple objects. And once filled, I'm going to fill black inside this, and then I have my white fill inside it. So select all these white fills and fill red color inside this.
Okay, so let's fill the rest of the map now. So here I have colored first half of the map, and what left is this one. So I'm going to leave it right now, and you guys might go ahead and fill this whole map. Now this might not be the correct way of filling the colors, because I don't know how you can fill colors in actual map, but my only intention behind this kind of fill is that if you have two countries which are connected to each other, and if you fill same color in these two countries, it might appear that it's a continuation of the same country. So that was the only idea when I was saying that no two connected countries should have same color. And I don't know the exact procedure how they actually fill the map. So yeah, this is just for a demo purpose, and I hope you understand how we can fill color using the swatches. So now let's learn the next thing, which is options on, or all the various options we have available in swatch panel. Alright, so I'm going to expand it a little, and yeah, this is fine for me. Now you have few buttons over here and two buttons over here. So, and we have this panel option. So we are going to cover each of them right now. So first of all, like I have said, these are the colors, and there you have these folders, and we have some patterns and gradient fields also. So what are gradients? We are going to cover it today in after some time. Okay, and now the first button is delete swatch. So you can select any of this color, and when you press this delete button, it's going to delete that swatch. So let's say I click on this one, this white color, and I click on delete. So now it's asking me delete the swatch selection. If I press yes, then that color is gone. So let's just undo it, because I really want that color to be here, because otherwise I'm just messing up with this group, and I don't want to do that. Now the next thing is this new icon. So new swatch, it says. So when you click on this, it will give you a color, and it is giving you a window where it has this color and color values, and when you press OK, it will create that color. So what you can do is either you can scroll this and you can make any color you want. Let's say if I want to make something like orange, so I would make like this, and when I press OK, so I have my new color over here. The other way to do this is you can just select your object in which you have a fill which you want to add in your swatch panel. So like this outermost part, or this whole part, has blue color filled inside it. So I have selected this object, and when I click on this new now, so it is giving me this color which I have filled already in this object. So when I click OK, so I have that color in my swatch panel, and this is kind of helpful trick that I generally use a lot, because let's say if I want to make a gradient out of this color, then I want to save this color and make a darker tone of this one. So here I have my color saved. Now I can just select this color and make a darker tone of this. So yeah, it helps me a lot. So it might be useful for you also. So just a little trick which I generally use for my work. Now let's see the next button, which is this new color group. So I think you would have guessed it by now that it is going to create this kind of group. So let's see how it works actually. So just click on this group. Now it's asking me the group name, so I'm gonna name it experimental group. I hope the spelling is right. Okay, the spelling is right. And yeah, so now you can see I had this color selected, and when I created group, so let's say GRP1 this time, so it automatically put that group into my, sorry, automatically put that color into my group.
If you want to create an empty group, then you can just click anywhere in this empty area and then click on the group icon and GRP1 and press enter, then you get an empty group. Now you can drag and drop colors in this group. Let's say if I want to put this blue, so I can just click on this blue color and drag it here and drop it on a group. So I have placed one color, and then the second one, same thing with the second one. You can again change the arrangement. Let's say if you want to put orange in front of orange before blue, then you can just drag orange before blue and it will change the arrangement. So yeah, it's very user friendly and you can do whatever you want in this panel. So I hope you you understood this. So let's say this group is called the complementary group, where I can just store the complementary colors here. So that's how you can create a group and store colors inside this. If you want to delete an entire group, just select the group and press delete button from here and click yes, so it will delete the entire group. Okay, so that was fairly simple. Now we have few options here, which says new swatch, we have seen already. Then it says new color group, we have covered that one also. Now it says select all unused, so when I click on select all unused, it will select all the swatches which I haven't used in this file, and based on that I can either delete all the swatches because I haven't used them, or it depends on your choice. It just gives you idea that which all colors you haven't used from the swatch panel, and then you have this delete swatches, which I'm not going to do right now. Then it says add used color, but so let's say okay, I have deselected all of them, and let's click on add used color. So here you can see it has added all those colors like black, red, orange, blue, yellow, green and blue, which I have used in this map. So instead of this, what I can do is create a new group, GRP1, and after selecting this group I can just go here and say add used color. And after that, I can just pick all these colors and drag it in here to create a group of all used colors, so that I know, yeah, like this is the color, which these all colors I have used in my file. And once my job is done or once my file is complete, I can just delete this group. So yeah, there are various ways to use it, and it depends on totally onto you how you want to use it. So let's just undo it instead, and yeah, that looks good. Then you have sort by name, sort by kind, and sort by show find field. So yeah, the name says pretty much everything what it does. And then you have this small thumbnail view, medium thumbnail view, large thumbnail view, and small list, large list view. So if I click on this, you can see my swatch size is increasing. And then you have this small list, which gives you the name and the color code and everything. And then you have this three color bar here. When you double click on this, you can actually edit the color. You can change it the way you want. Okay, then you have large list view, which just increase the size of the icon, but it's just like the small list. Okay, so I'm gonna keep it large thumbnail view so that it is visible to you clearly. I should have kept it from the beginning, but I don't know why I didn't do it. So yeah, now I have done it, so it will be better visible to you now. So the next important option here is open swatch library. And then you have save your swatches and swatch library as AI. So you have these two extensions in which you can save your swatches, your custom made swatches. Like we have created this group, and if you put some colors inside this, we can actually save this swatch library. Anyways, so let's see this option which says open swatch library. So here you have various libraries. Like this one is a default library provided by Illustrator. You can even access these libraries from this icon at the bottom left. If you click on this, you will get the same submenu which you get from here. Okay, so it's the same. Let's just open one of the library and let's see what it gives us and what it does. So click on Ancient, and here you have your new panel window. And again, you can go to here and say large thumbnail view. Okay. So here you have all your colors which are different from this one. So it is actually a library. It is also default library. So which says ancient. Now it has all the colors which are related to that theme. So again, you can go over here and open one more library which says gradients, and let's say
gradients we haven't covered, but still let's say open season. So here you have all these gradients and which comes under this library. From here, if you open one more library, let's say flowers, so you get one more library here. And the colors this time are related to flowers. So yeah, now like you have two windows here. So what you can do is if you keep opening new libraries from here, it will keep stacking in this window. But if you want to change this library to something else, you can just go over here and change it from here. So yeah, you have two options. If you want to open multiple libraries, you can go to the main swatch panel and open libraries from here, like this one has corporate colors. But if you want to change this library to something else, you can change it from here, from this swatch library menu in this window itself. Otherwise, you can just drag it out and close it to close all the libraries. Now, other than plain color and gradients, we also have patterns in these libraries. So like here you can see this says pattern. So it has three submenus, which are basic, graphics, decorative and nature. So let's open one of them and let's see how it goes. This is having natural patterns inside it. So let's select one of our object and fill any of the color. Okay, so you can see here that it has filled some kind of pattern. Now, we have already covered in our previous chapters that if you want to scale pattern and if you just want to transform the pattern instead of shape, how can you do that? So yeah, you can use that knowledge. You can apply that knowledge over here also. So I'm gonna just undo it right now because I don't need that weird feel inside my map. Okay, so here are all the options which are available in swatches, and these many options are good enough to do any kind of work you want. I have missed few of the options intentionally because they are not very useful, and so far like I'm using Illustrator from last 6 to 7 years and I haven't encountered using those options anytime in this 6 to 7 years. So I have just left them so delete this group. And now let's move on to our next topic, which is gradients. Okay, so to learn gradient, instead of using this file, I think we should use another file, or let's just experiment in this file itself. So what we are going to do is select one of this shape. Let's say this shape is big enough to for a demo, and you can move it around or okay, whatever. So you have this shape, and now what I want is to fill gradient inside this shape. I don't want a fixed color like this one, a single flat color. I want a gradient something like this. So how can I do that? Oh, I just did that. But yeah, how can you modify that and how can you control those gradients? So we'll learn now. Okay, so to fill the gradient, one of the options is you can go to swatches and you have these 3-4 gradients over here. You can select any of them. And this is the one way. The other way is you can select your gradient tool by pressing G on your keyboard, or you can click on this kind of icon from your menu bar. So once you have your gradient tool, you first make sure that you have your object selected where you want to fill the gradient, and then select the gradient tool. Once selected, you can just click and drag anywhere on your canvas. Now note, anywhere on your canvas, I'm not saying you just have to move it on your shape. You can move anywhere on your canvas and it will fill the gradient accordingly. But nothing is happening right now. I'm filling the gradient, but nothing is happening because we don't have any already filled gradient inside this shape. Gradient tool will only work if you have already filled the gradient inside your shape. So yeah, we know like we can click on these 4 icons or 4 swatches to fill a gradient, then this tool will work. The other way to fill the gradient is you can click on this gradient panel also, or open it from the window menu, click on gradient over here. So it is already checked on, that means my panel is open. Okay, so here you have at the top right, you have this gradient button. Beside it, there is a small down arrow button on which if you click, you get the same 4 gradients which you had in swatches. So you can click on any of them and that also works the same. It will fill that gradient into your selected shape. Okay, so once you fill the gradient, you can see that this line has appeared. And for the sake of simplicity, I'll just select a white and black gradient right now. So yeah, you can see you have this line over here. Now if you want to modify your gradient, you can just click and drag anywhere on your canvas and you can see my gradient is changing accordingly. So let's say I want to fill gradient from top left corner to the bottom right, and I just drag it something like this, and there I have my gradient fill. So gradient is just like a gradual change of color from one to another. So like here I have this white color and the black color. So it's just a gradual shift of color from one to another one. Okay, now if you want to create an exact vertical line or exact horizontal line or gradient, you can just drag, and while dragging you can hold the shift key to make your gradient, and now you can see my gradient is exactly snapping on a vertical axis. When you move closer to 45 degree angle, then it works the same like other tools where you are snapped to 45 degree angle, and if you go close to the horizontal line, then your gradient tool or your gradient axis snaps to a horizontal axis. So yeah, like this I can fill a perfectly horizontal gradient or a perfectly vertical gradient. So it all depends on to you what you want to do with your gradient. Okay, so having learned that, let's move and learn some advanced options of the gradients. So first option we have here is linear and radial. So we have two kind of gradients. First one is linear. This one is linear gradient, and the radial one is circular one. So like you can see, there are these circles you can see around here. Even if I select the gradient tool now, press G, then when I hover over this shape or this gradient line, you can see there is a circle now instead of a line. When I select the linear gradient, I get this line. Okay, so we will cover radial gradient after some time. First of all, let's see the linear itself. Okay, now we can fill gradient in both the fill as well as in the outlines. So you can have gradient in both shape as well as the outlines. And how can you fill gradient in outlines? Again, we are going to cover it today after some time. But here we have this angle thing. So like if you draw gradient or if you create gradient in any angle, you can see this angle is reflecting here also. So again, you can select values from this drop down menu, or you can just type your own values if you are very sure about the angle. So let's say I want 57 degrees, so I just typed 57, pressed enter, and I have my gradient inclined at 57 degrees. Okay, so that's very simple. And there's this button on the left side which is called reverse gradient. So like the name says, it will just reverse your gradient. So it will switch the black with white and the white with black. So let's just click and see how it is reflected over here. So I'm just gonna click here, and immediately you can see my gradient has been reversed. And it is very simple. It is very simple with two colors, but the main functionality of this one you will be able to notice when you have multiple colors in your gradient. So talking about multiple colors, how can I create a multiple color gradient? So let's see it now. So you can see here I have a bar over here, and I have two buckets with me, and when I hover over to this line, you can see the same bar over here, and there are two pointers, one is black one and one is white one. So these two things are the same actually. So let's create it a horizontal gradient first so that we are sure about what we are doing. Okay, and at the top you have this small square. It might be hard to see, but there's a small square over here, and if you click and move it, this is actually this diamond thing on this gradient slider. Okay, so let's just undo it right now. Now before talking about or before learning about multiple colors, let's first experiment few things with gradient tool itself. So in gradient tool so far we have learned how we can create a gradient, and now we will see what this line or how this line can actually help in aligning or making some changes in the gradients. So we have these two things, one is the circle one and one is the diamond one or the square one. So So when you click on this circle and move, you are actually moving the initial position of your gradient. This will be better visible in radial one, but we are learning just the linear gradient. So let's just stick to it right now. Okay, so like you can see, I can actually move my gradient the way I want. And if you click on this diamond or on this square, then you are increasing or decreasing the length of your gradient. So I can make it this small or I can make it this large. It totally depends on to me then. Because like here you can see I have created a gradient which is very, it is a very sharp change in colors, and this is not looking very good. And there are some places where this kind of gradient actually looks very good. Like if you are making a steel rod or something, then this kind of gradient change is required there, and it will obviously look better there. But here we don't need that kind of gradual or sudden change in color. So I'm just gonna again position it somewhere here and again make it to the end of this right curve. Alright. So that's how this two button works. And now we have these two pointers. So if I click on one of this pointer and move, you can see I'm actually moving this white color, and the similar changes can be seen here on the gradient panel. Again, if I move this black pointer, so I'm moving the black bucket actually. So that's how this works. So you can either change it from here or change it from here. It doesn't matter. Now this top part, this top small button here, which is a square one. So if you click and move on this slider, then you can see the top diamond is moving. So this slider, so this diamond actually decides how much part of the gradient or how much part of this gradient slider will be covered by a single gradient. This is the point where both of these colors are 50-50%. So it, let's say at this point, white is 50% and black is 50%. So you can decide where you want to actually position it. So again, now at the bottom you have this location. So if you click on this diamond and then you have this location, you can type your own values. Let's say it should be at 50 right now. And similarly for the buckets, you have these two options enabled now. One is opacity and the second one is location. So we will come to opacity after some time. Let's first see the location. So like we have changed the location for this diamond, we can do it for these buckets also. Let's say 50% or 80%, or you can type your own values also. Right now I'm just gonna type 0 and click enter, press enter. Same for this another bucket, it's the same thing. So either you can change the values or you can type it, or you can just drag it on the slider. Okay, so after knowing that, I think now we are in a good position to learn about creating multiple color gradients. So to create multiple color gradients, you can either go over here, click anywhere in on the bottom hand side of this slider. If you click somewhere on the bottom border or somewhere near to its position, then it will create a new bucket. It will be reflected again at this position also. So when I make gradients, I actually prefer making it in gradient panel rather than doing it here, because this is very abstract. If I have this closed, I don't even know what I'm doing, and this option might be unavailable in some older versions of the Illustrator. So whenever I make gradients, I prefer using this gradient panel than this slider. Okay, so let's just do it from gradient panel itself. But anyways, even if I do it from here or here, it will be the same thing. You can create your buckets here. You can double click on this to change the color and or whatever you want. So yeah. So to create a bucket in the gradient panel, you can just click and drag at the bottom side of this slider anywhere, and it will create the bucket. So here, after creating the bucket, you have this diamond two times. So this diamond shows the gradual decrease or gradual change of color from this bucket to this one, and this diamond shows the gradual change of color from this one to this one. So what if I want to change color for this bucket, for the middle one? So to do that, you have to first select the bucket. So to select bucket, you can just click on that bucket and it will be selected. After selecting, you can just double click on that and it will open this color panel for you. Now you have this swatches here and you have this color here. So you can go to any one of them and select any of the color you want. So let's say I want red here, or I want a light gray or a black. I can select anything I want here. The same thing, I can do it from this color options also. Here there's one more thing which I have, is this top right button, which is giving me few different color modes also. So like right now I'm working on RGB. I can either select CMYK or HSB or grayscale, any of them. It again depends on the kind of project you are doing. If you have project mode, or you're if you're working on something which is going to be printed, then you rather want to work on CMYK than RGB. If you are just working it for your own designs, or you're making a desktop wallpaper, or you're just keeping it for yourself, then you can work on RGB also, because RGB gives more bright color than CMYK. So I can slide these pointers on this slider, and I can select any color I want. Okay, so once selected, I can just leave it, and there you have your multiple color gradient. And now you can either drag this top diamonds, and you can change the gradient the way you want. Okay, so, and here also, if you think the black is too much, you can just drag it and make something like this. Again, you can drag the buckets, and so yeah, that's how this all setup works. And the only thing we have left now is, what if I want to delete this gradient? So, or not the gradient, what if I want to delete this bucket particularly and leave these two like this? So for that, I can just click on this bucket and drag down. So you can see the bucket has been removed. I haven't released my mouse yet. When I release my mouse, it will be deleted. If I accidentally go up, so you can see the bucket has appeared again. So just drag down, release your mouse to delete your gradient bucket. Okay, so I'm just gonna press undo right now, Control Z on my keyboard, and let's see how reverse gradient works here. Because previously when we saw reverse gradient, it just switched the color, but this time we have this bucket somewhere not at 50%, somewhere at 63%. So let's see how this reverse gradient will work now. So let's click on this button, and it has exactly mirrored my gradient. So even you can see this bucket position is 36%, which is 100 minus the previous value, I think 64 or something. Yeah, 63.05. So it has exactly mirrored my whole gradient. So it is a very good option that you will find it useful at many places. Okay, now at the top right, we have this option which says hide option. So when you click on this, it will hide all the options except your gradient slider. And there's just one option here, so there's nothing new or nothing fancy to learn about. So this is the overall thing how gradient works. Now we have seen the linear gradient, now let's see how radial gradient will work. So going to the radial gradient, now the working is similar in this panel. There's nothing new in this panel. You can change any color the way you want. You can reverse your gradient, and then you have this few more buttons. So nothing has been changed in the gradient panel. The only one thing that has changed is this thing, aspect ratio. So from here you can, the right now aspect ratio is 100%. You can change it to 10%, 20%, 30%, or anything you want. So you can see at 100% my radial gradient is perfectly circular. But when I decrease this value, so it is being squashed. And we can go to 10%, even we can go to 1%. You can just type value here and press enter. So you can see there is a very thin line over here. And you might find it useful at places when you want to create a certain amount of glow coming out from a very far distance object. Like if you see space light or something, you might want to use this kind of gradient over there. Okay, so if I go to higher values, let's say 200%, so my gradient is being stretched vertically. Now you might not be able to notice it here, so what we are going to do is select our gradient tool, press G on your keyboard, and you can see this circle has been stretched a lot vertically. Okay, so let's zoom in, and
Now there are few changes in gradient tool, so we'll see it now. This slider is still the same. The top part and bottom part works the same like in linear gradient. And even this one, when I click on this square or diamond, it will increase or decrease the size of my overall gradient, no matter whether it's linear or radial. From the center, I can position my gradient anywhere I want now. Previously, when we were using the radial linear gradient, at that time it was automatically snapping to the center of my object, but that's not the case in radial. You can click and drag anywhere you want and it will be repositioned at that particular place. Okay, so let's say top left corner, and from here on this circle you have two other buttons. One is this black dot and one is this ring black dot. So let's click on this one and see what it does. It is actually squashing my gradient, so nothing new about it. You could either do it from gradient panel, or if you want to do it from the tool, you have this option over here. I'm not able to make change again because it is so close to the slider. So I actually want to zoom in and then drag it. Okay, so that's better now. Now let's see what this ring circle will do. So just click on this and drag. So you can see it works the same way like this used to work. It is just increasing or decreasing this overall scale of my gradient. Okay. Now if you hover over this ring anywhere, so you can see my cursor has been changed to this rotate icon. So from here you can rotate your gradient. And same thing can be done from this angle in gradient panel. So you can change your values to 30 or minus 30 or minus 60, anything. Here I prefer using gradient tool over the panel because while using gradient tool, I get live preview of where my gradient is actually going to be. So again, it depends on to you when you start working on Illustrator and when you start creating your own work. You will be having your own preferences, what you want to be, what you want to do with which tool, or which tool you prefer over which command. So it's not something tricky, it just comes naturally. You will be using the software in the way you want. So it's just again a personal preference, and there's nothing, no rule or nothing about it. Okay, so that's sufficient about learning the gradient tool or gradient panel. And after this, you will be able to create variety of things using the gradient. So let's just create something using gradient and let's see how it works. So now what I want to do is I want to create a cylinder. So for that, I have created a square now, and we are going to fill a gradient inside this. So let's say white and black this time. And like I was saying, when you are working on some steel, or if you are trying to create a steel or some rod made of steel, then you will be having very sharp change in gradient. So we are going to see it now. So what I'm going to do is create multiple gradients over here, or multiple color buckets, and I'm just repositioning them in any random way. Okay, so here and here. And what I want now is I have achieved, let's make outline none, or you can actually just make it very light. Now I have achieved some kind of texture like that, but it has no depth in it. So let's add that. Open the gradient panel, select the object, make sure you have fill selected as your active one, not the outline. And let's just make some more changes into this, and okay. After that, in the beginning, we can just switch to grayscale and make this perfectly black. In the center, we can change color values and we can make it a little bright. And center one should be perfectly white actually. So double click on this bucket, go to grayscale and make it look like a very shiny one. Okay, so now if I look, it gives me a feel that yes, it is a kind of circular or something. Still I have
few things over here, which is this one, which doesn't give me exact look that this is circular. So we can again select it and make some more changes into this one. So yeah, like here you can see now it started giving me that kind of look that I am working on some cylinder made of steel and it is very reflective. So yeah, that's how you can create variety of things using just a gradient. Now if I actually look at this shape, I feel a single color inside this. It is just like this. So you can imagine that how much change a gradient fill can bring in an object. Alright, so that's enough about gradient. Now let's see a few things about stroke. So we have been creating all these shapes since beginning, well, since we start learning Illustrator, and we know two things, that each object has two things here. One is fill and one is outline, which is also called stroke. So what if I want to modify this outline? So to see that, first of all, let's create a perfect square here. Hold the shift and create using a rectangle tool to create a square, and let's just reposition it somewhere in the center. Okay, so that's enough. Now you can access stroke properties in two ways. First is you can go to window and open stroke panel from here, which is Control F10 is a shortcut key for that. So just click on this and it will open a stroke panel for you, or you can just click on this stroke in the option bar. So if you click on this, you will get the exact same thing over here. So I'm going to use stroke panel because it stays at a place other than this one, which just closes at a single click. So I'm just going to use this thing. Okay, so the first option we have here is weight. So we can increase the weight of the stroke as much as we want. Let's say 100 pixels and 100 points, sorry. And even you can type your own custom values, let's say 1000, and there is our stroke. Actually, it is a stroke. It is so wide that it has covered the entire shape. Okay, so let's just undo and make it 10 points, I think. That will be visible to you. Okay, now we have this cap thing, which is three kind of cap is being provided to us. One is butt cap. Now, I don't know why it is named like this, but just know that it is butt cap, okay? And the second one is round cap, and the third one is projecting cap. And then we have the three kind of corners, which is meter join and round join and then bevel join. Okay, so let's see all of them. First of all, let's see the join corners instead of cap. We are going to cover cap after some time. Okay, so corners here. So right now we have this meter join, which is exactly sharp corners. So select the shape and then let's click on this rounded join, and immediately you can see my corners has a little rounded edge at every single corner. Okay, when I create on the bevel join, so you can see it has been chiseled, and now my square looks like this. So again, it depends on to you what kind of look you want for your artwork. So right now I'm just gonna select rounded join, and now let's see what this cap can do. So create a very thick outline here. Instead of 10, I'm gonna use 20. Okay, so now you can see this is my outline, this is my shape actually, this thing, and it has a stroke which is exactly positioning at the same place. So right now it has this butt cap selected. If I go to round cap, you can see it has created a round or the circles around my end points. And if I select this projecting cap, so you can see instead of rounds, now I have squares at my closing ends or at my extreme ends. Okay, so just keep it rounded cap right now because it just looks better. Alright. After that, we have this align stroke. To understand this, we will see here. Yeah, so right now you can see my stroke is halfway inside and halfway outside. My real shape is this one. So I'm just pressing Ctrl Y to go into outline mode. So if you press Ctrl Y again, you will come back to preview mode. So in outline mode, you can see that this is my actual shape. okay. But when I go to my preview mode, you can see that my outline is halfway inside my shape and halfway outside my shape. So you can change that if you click on this second icon which says align stroke to inside. So my whole outline will come inside my shape. Now if I press Ctrl Y this time, so you can see that yeah, my outline is literally inside the shape. And opposite to that, this last option work, which will say, which says align stroke to outside. So if I click on this one, you can see my whole stroke has gone outside the shape. Okay, so that was very simple. Now we have this dashed lines and arrowheads and all this disabled option. Now how will that work? We are actually going to see it in a live example. We will create something and we'll try to understand it from there. But before learning that example, I actually missed one thing, which is opacity in gradients. So let's just see it very quickly. So here I have the same example open, and this time I'm going to select a country and just drag it on this blue part. Okay. Open my gradient panel and fill any gradient you want. Okay, let's see. Let's just select this gradient there. Okay. So here I have this white to black transition in my gradient. Now if you select any of this bucket, it will enable this opacity option. So let's say I have a drop down here, so I can select the opacity value of that particular color. So if I click 0 here, now you can see there is a gradual transition of color, but my color has gone transparent. So now I can actually see the background color from this shape. Now to make it, if I unselect this shape, now you can see there is still a little amount of white here, which I don't want. I want it perfectly black. So I can just select this shape, double click on this and go to grayscale and make it look exactly black. And now if I go here, you can see it looks like it's coming out of the blue. Or it's coming out of this blue color. Yeah, so again you can go to this top diamond part, which is which will define the center position of your gradient, and then you can move it to the extreme right, and now you can see it has come out really nice. So if you want to work with transparency, then you have an option now which will make your object look transparent. Now there are a few other options for the transparency, and we are going to see it in future videos, but this is one of the most powerful option which you will be using a lot if you want to create some kind of reflections, or if you want to make your object transparent, semi-transparent or anything. Because you can select this shape, and if you select this bucket, instead of making it 0%, you can either make it 50% or something. So this time it has a certain amount of black fill, but that black is actually translucent, and you can see some amount of blue behind the black, and this one is exactly sharp black. You can again select, you can again change your gradient pattern, reverse the gradient, and if you press G, you can actually scale it a bit, or select the first bucket or the last one this time, because we have reversed the gradient, and press 0. So here you can see how nicely it can change things once you just add a little bit of transparency into a single color. Again, it opens a new level of experiment window, so you feel free to experiment with these options as much as you want. And we will open our example for the stroke, and we will see how those dashed line will work. Okay, so let's open this stroke example, and so here I have this stroke example. I have the same map here, but and I have this India as a center point, and it says that okay, from here you can go to these places. It's just simple four locations, and this is arc actually. If I open my layers, here I have in one layer I have this map, so I can just hide and show it. And the second layer, which is arrows, I have all these arcs. So this arc has been created just by using this arc tool, nothing special. And then after I used direct selection tool to change their control handles a bit. Okay, and now what I want is I want these arcs to look like this one. So like here you can see it has an arrow in the beginning and there's a circle at the end here. And then you have this gradual increase of width also along with the gradient. So there is a gradient from red to yellow, but there is also a width change. So how can we change the width like this? I mean, we have seen how to increase the overall width or how to increase the overall width of the stroke. But how can we make it look fat from one end and decrease its size from other end? So there is an option for that and we are going to see it in this example. Okay, so I should hide the map layer, I think, because it will be better visible to you then. These arrow will be visible better. Okay, so to begin with, let's select our first line or the arc which you want to change and then go to our stroke panel. Once stroke panel is open, you can check this dashed line to enable all these options. So click on this, and as soon as I click on this, immediately you can see my stroke has changed to a dotted line. So already we have achieved one thing, which is creating these dotted lines. So the only thing we have to do is just modify it a bit. Okay, so the second thing to achieve is increase the width a bit, let's say 2 points right now. Okay, so 2 points look better. Now we have these two buttons here, which says, the first one says preserve exact dash and gap lengths. The second one says align dashes to corners and path ends, adjusting length to fit. Now by reading the description, you won't be able to make anything what it says. So to understand that, let's go back to our this file and here we will be able to understand it better. So now we know if we want to make a dash line, we can just check on this box and it will create dash lines. Now if I want to make this look circular, then I can just select this rounded cap instead of a butt cap. And here you have this rounded corners for all the dashes. Okay, so first of all, let's increase the dash width, which is 12 points right now. I want to make it 20 points so that it's at a larger distance. And right now the second option is selected. It says align dashes to corners and path ends, adjusting length to fit. Okay, so actually to change this option, the first one is selected by default, but if you want to change this option, you have to select this kind of stroke, which is both inside and outside the shape, then only it will work. And that's just another weird way the Illustrator works, because I don't know the exact reason why it works like this, but this is the procedure that if you want to change these two options, and then you have to, instead of these two one, you have to select this center stroke, which is both the outside and inside the shape. And not only this, when we are going to learn about filling gradients inside the stroke at the same time or changing the width of the stroke, we have to do the same thing. We cannot have these two strokes at that time. Only stroke we can use is this center stroke. Okay, so now we have these two options enabled. As you can see, the first one works like this. It starts from the starting point and it keep making your dashes till you reach the end. And it doesn't care anything about the shape or anything about preserving the dashes. It just know that I have to start from the first corner, make a complete dash, and after that give a gap and then dash and give a gap and then dash. So yeah, and now if I check this second option, so this is actually a smart one. So now you can see if I have box selected, I'm getting this very nice corners at the box compared to the first one, which just create a dotted one and it doesn't care about the corners or anything. It just has to do his job and finish all those dotted lines. But the second one is actually a smart one. It adjusts these dots and it creates that kind of outlines, which preserves the corners properly. And yeah, again, it depends what kind of example you want to create. So like here, if I select any one of them, it doesn't matter, because this one has both the ends preserved. If I select second one, it has both the ends which are half cut. So it doesn't matter to me. I'm just gonna select the first one. At least I'm getting both the ends properly here. Okay, the second thing is this dash length, which we have seen. If I increase it from 12 point to 20 point, I can increase my dash length. Now this one says the gap, so height works. Now you can see here we have this dash gap, dash gap, dash gap three times. So the working is very simple. So first one says, let's say this is the dash of 12 points. Let me use another file for you guys. Control shift Z to redo. Okay, so the first one says that this is the dash for 12 points. Okay, and then if you don't type anything in here, it will by default take the first value. And the second one says the gap of 12 points. Again, the third one says the dash of 12 points and the gap of 12 points, and similarly a dash of 12 points and a gap of 12 points. So what we are going to do is create these gaps in gray. I'm just holding the shift and dragging with my selection tool to have multiple selection. And let's have the fill grayed out. So this is how it will work. Now you can see here that how my dotted line is created. First it creates a gap, creates the dash, then it creates a gap, then the dash, then the gap, then the dash. So now you have the ability to change this gap length, and the second dash it is going to create again of the gap after second dash, then the third dash, then the gap after third dash. Again, after that, it is going to repeat from here. So after all these three patterns, it will again repeat itself, something like this. And it goes on till your shape lasts. Okay, so let's see it on some shape or something. So I can actually extend this line here, make it horizontal. And now here we can experiment with our dashed lines. So first create the dashes. Okay, now it has 20 points, and I'm gonna use butt cap right now because it gives me more precise value, or it shows me the exact result which I want to see. And decrease its width or the stroke width to 10 points and make dash 40 points here. Okay, so now you can see there is a dash and a gap of equal size. Okay, so select this. Now I want to reduce the gap between these dashes, so I can make it 10 points. So now you can see that all these dashes has been come closer, and the gap is 10 pixels now. Now after that, if you want after first dash and the gap, I want a dash which is 10 pixels again. So now the second dash is 10 pixels, and the gap after that is I think 40 pixels or something. So again, you can change this gap to, let's say, 10 pixels again. So now you can see that how it has changed. So we have changed two dash right now and two gaps. So again, make this dash. What should I give? Actually, just make it 20 pixels, 20 points, second dash, and the third dash 5 points. And the gap should be again 10 points. I'm keeping gap similar to avoid the confusion. So now you can see I have this first dash, second dash, and this third dash really small, and after that it's repeating its pattern again and again, and the gap is 10 pixels or 10 points every time. So this is how it works, and you can create actually a variety of lines or dotted lines using this option. Just practice with this a bit more so you make sure you understand these properties very clearly. Alright, so now let's see the arrowhead. So I have this gap aligned properly, and I have my width, a little bit of width, and now let's add some arrowheads here. So we have two arrowheads, one for the beginning and one for the end. So let's just add one arrow at the beginning, and I think arrow 7 is the one which looks exactly like this one. Okay, so it has reversed, and we won't worry about it right now. We will just keep adding this. And at the end, I want this circle, which is arrow 21. So just click on this drop down, scroll down till we find this arrow 21 and click on this. So I have a circle and the arrow, but it is in opposite direction. So it would be really nice if I have option which can actually reverse the arc or the reverse the arrow. So yes, I have this option over here beside it. So if I click on this, it will just reverse these arrows. So yeah, now I have this circle at the end and this arrow at the beginning. Now at the bottom, it says the scale of this first arrowhead is 100% and the second arrowhead is 100%. So you can increase or decrease the scale from here. So does it make any sense? You can see, can you see? Okay, I haven't selected my arrow or my arc, so it is not reflecting any changes. So select my arc first and then change the values here. So you can see my arrow is getting really small here, and here is my arrow which I don't want. So let's just make it 100%. So similarly, you can decrease the width of your or the size of your rounded arrow also, which I'm not going to do it right now. And there's two buttons over here which says, the first one says extend arrow tip beyond the end of the path, and the second one says place arrow tip at the end of the path. So what does that mean? So let's zoom in, and here is our path end, this one, this point. Okay, and here we have our arrow. So this option says place arrow tip at the end of the path, which is actually what it's doing. But if I select this first one, then it will place my arrow outside my path. So once my path finishes, then it's going to place my arrow after that. And the same thing applies at the other end also here. Now you can see my arrow is here somewhere. When I select the second one, so my arrow is inside the path. And this is what I want right now. I don't want this kind of stuff. So just select the second option and click OK and press Ctrl 0 now. So yeah, we have achieved the arrows, we have achieved dotted lines, but again, this dotted line, if you see, these are flat ones. I want rounded caps, so you can select rounded cap to make them rounded. All right, now what about the width and the gradient? So first of all, let's see the width and then we'll talk about the gradient. Okay, to change the width, so far we have changing the width of arrow uniformly. So for the whole arc, this width used to be the same. But what if I want to change this width non-uniformly? So we can do that using our width tool. So the shortcut key for that is Shift W, or you can select it from your toolbar. So let's press Shift W on our keyboard to select the tool. Okay, so again, to use that tool, you have to select your path first and then you can select the tool. Now, as soon as I go here on my curve or on my arc, you can see it is showing something over here. And let's zoom in, and now I can click on anywhere in between the path, and now you can see how it is working. So the functionality is really simple. Just click and drag anywhere on your path and it will increase the width of your stroke. To make it more clear, let's take an example which doesn't have this dotted line. So like this one. So zoom in a bit and Shift W to select the width tool, and at this end, I am just clicking and dragging to increase the width of my path, okay, or the stroke. Alright, so this is done. Now this end is just like that. This end has the default 1 point width. So again, you can change it from here also. You can select and drag. Okay, we are selecting the different one. So the problem is we have so many lines colliding at a single point. So what I'm gonna do is select this one, right click and say isolate selected path. So now I have this path selected only. I won't be accessing other paths inside this. Okay, this is called the isolation mode. To get out of the isolation mode, you can double click anywhere outside your path, or you can just click on this arrow here to go back to your layer. Okay, so click right click and go to set isolation path. All right. Now this width tool, I can actually go anywhere in this path and change the width accordingly. It doesn't matter that whether you are at the anchor points or at some particular place, you can change the width at any place you want. Okay, now if I want to change the width at existing point where I have changed it already, let's say at the corner, if I want to change it, I can again go over to that point and it will show me these two sliders. I can again click on one of them and I can drag to change the width again. Here also I can just drag at these corners and I can change the width. Now if you want to change the width of one side only and leaving the other side intact, you can hold your Alt key and click on one of these circles and just drag. So now you can see I'm changing the width of only one side and the other side is staying at a place. So you can see how powerful is this software. It gives you a variety of ways or a variety of customization option, and overall mixing them gives you a complete level of freedom where you can actually create anything you want. So yeah, now again if you click and drag on this circle, then you are changing the width of both sides. Alright, now if you select the tool and go to any of these points, existing points, and double click on them, you can open your width point edit option. So here you can change the side of one side, or decrease the side of one side, or increase or decrease the size of other side. Or when you click on this link button, then you are changing them proportionally or combinedly. Okay, so just uncheck them. And then this is total width, which will do the same thing. So you can increase and decrease width overall. Alright, so either you can click on delete to delete that point and leave your shape like this. Okay, so having learned that, now we might be able to make something like this. So let's just do it. And before that, let's just undo this thing because I want my curve back like that. Okay, so press Shift W this time. And here we are going to select this corner point and expand it a bit. And I think this much width is fine. Yeah, this looks good. Now as soon as we increase the width, you can see that all these dots has come closer. So to avoid that, we might want to increase this value. So let's say make this dash 30 points. And 30 points is, I think, a little too much. So let's make it 25 points. And yes, that looks okay. But as soon as I make all the changes and I'm like, okay, this is going good, this arrow is really small here and I can't even see it. So, but we know if we want to change the arrow size, what we have to do. So under this arrow, we have this scale option. So we can just go and increase it and until it comes to the size of the one which we want to copy. And yeah, here I think these both look similar. Now we can either go to the other end and match these two circles, and this one is a little bigger, so just drop its value by 1 point and 9% is fine. Okay, so this has come out really well, and now the only part left is filling the gradient inside it. So select this shape or select this path, and now we have stroke as our active part. And here we can again go to gradient panel and it says we don't have any gradient fill. So select any of the gradient and now you can fill the gradient the way you are filling in shapes. So yeah, it's the same thing. The way you are filling the gradients in the shape, the same way you can make all the changes in the path also. Even the transparency and everything will work in path also, or sorry, in the stroke also. So yeah, let's just make these colors and then we'll be done with our arrow, okay, or our this curve. Alright, so select one of them, double click on this bucket, go to RGB and make it red. Alright, the second color we want to select is the yellow one. So here I have my yellow, And now I have these two things which is exactly the similar. Now this red is a little brighter than this one, so we might want to drop the value of red a bit and make it look a little dark. Okay, even this yellow is very bright, so just drop this value a bit. Okay, so yeah, now they looks kind of similar. A little bit more, I think. Okay, so after this there are some 2-3 more options inside the stroke gradient, so which we should see or we should know about. So let's create a circle first. Okay, and now you can see it's copying my strokes value everywhere. So this is how Illustrator preserves all the customization. So you can again change it by just clicking on this, and there you go. Okay, here also just remove this dash, and there I have my shape. Okay, so here again I want to fill the gradient stroke or gradient inside the stroke. So let's just make outline a little thicker, 20 points. Okay, and let's take out this gradient panel. So we have this stroke and gradient panel open at the same time. Now you can see I have this align stroke to the center, so this should be selected before we do all these changes. Okay, now here I have this two color field which is black and white gradient, and from here you have these two buttons which are the only thing, which are the only changes between the stroke and fill gradients. So like these three options you can change between any of them. The first one says apply gradient within stroke, the second one says apply gradient along stroke, and the third one says apply gradient across stroke. So right now first one is selected, which is just a single line. If you press G here, okay, one more thing, gradient tool will not work in the stroke, so all the modification you are doing, you have to do it from the gradient panel itself. So gradient tool will only work on the shape, on the fill actually, not on the stroke. Okay, so let's select the second option and we will see how it changes. So now you can see that gradient has been applied along my stroke here. And what is this extra circle over here? Okay, it's because of this rounded joint. So that's another bug I think with the Illustrator, that it's creating one extra circle with it by itself. So let's select this corner joint, and okay, so now you can see it has filled my gradient along the stroke. So it started from here and it ended again here. So that's how the second fill works. The third one is kind of this one, where it fills a gradient something like this along the stroke. Sorry, not along the stroke, it is across the stroke. Okay, so if you want to create any kind of shadow or something, you might want to use such kind of gradient option for your shape. Now you will you can see that if I select these two, any of these two, then my these two options are disabled, align stroke. So again, if you are making changes in this gradient stroke, you can't have your stroke which is inside the shape or outside the shape. You have to have your stroke which is halfway inside or halfway outside. So if I, let's say if I select this align stroke to outside, then I won't be able to select these two options. So I have to have this kind of stroke, and then only I will be able to select gradient types from here. So that's just one more thing which I wanted to bring in notice, that this is how it will work. Otherwise you might will get confused while working with the strokes, and you might get frustrated that what is actually going on. So this is just a common functionality that Illustrator works. It's no kind of bug, or maybe they haven't figured out how these two things will work together. So yeah, having known that, let's move on. And the next thing we are going to see is eyedropper tool. Okay, so let's select the same file itself actually. So eyedropper tool is very simple. The only thing is it does is pick properties of one shape and apply it to the current shape or the current selected one. So let's have some color field inside this. Okay, And now I want is to apply this same color in this circle also. So what can I do is select this shape or select the circle, press I on my keyboard to select the eyedropper tool. Immediately you can see this tool is active. So either you can select this tool from your toolbar also by clicking on some kind of icon like this. And when this eyedropper tool is selected, now I can click anywhere to pick that kind of color. Okay, so if I click on this canvas outside my artboard, then it will pick this gray color. Okay, so if I click inside my canvas, then inside my artboard, then it will pick the white color. And when I click on this shape, it will pick the shape color. Okay, so that is very simple, but it actually works then more than this. The eyedropper tool here doesn't just picks up the color, it picks up the entire properties of that shape and applies it to a new shape. So let's say if this shape has red color fill in it, okay, and I want, okay, this red is too bright, so orange looks better. And I want the same color to be applied here. So if I select this shape, this circle, and I pick eyedropper tool and I click on this, so you can see it has even picked the stroke gradient, even the stroke width. The only thing it hasn't picked is, where is my gradient panel? Here should it be? Okay, so let's talk it again. The only thing it hasn't picked is these three options, and to make them work, we have to select this option from here again and go to the outline, and then it will work. So yeah, that's how this eyedropper tool works. So now if we go here and I want to create this kind of arrow or implement this kind of properties of these arrows to these two curves, so I can select any of this curve, pick eyedropper tool and click on one of these curves. So here you can see it has picked the width, the dashed lines and the gaps and everything. The only thing it hasn't picked is my arrowheads and the customized width which I have created using width tool. So that I can do just by selecting these arrows, and here is arrow 21, I think. Okay, now drop down its value. We know the circle should be 9% and this one should be 32. So let's just make it 32. Okay, and then we can isolate this path. Isolate selected path and pick up our width tool, shift W. And then we can decrease the width of the last one. And there I have my arrow ready. So much of work, I can just do it very quickly. When on the other hand, when I was creating this arrow or this, when I was modifying this path, it took me almost 10 to 15 minutes to modify this path itself. Here I have just made all these changes in couple of minutes, I think 1 minute or two. So that's how it is useful, and that is the working of eyedropper tool. The only thing I have missed here is the gradient alignment. So I might want to go to the gradient panel here and adjust this angle a bit. So make it 120 degree. This looks good. Okay, so here I have my third path ready also. Now I can go to shape layer and unhide this map, and here I have few arrows which are coming from India and going to several other countries. We can add some more effect to this so that these arrows are visible, and even we can manage the color schemes, because this white over yellow, or sorry, yellow over white doesn't look very good. So we have to do something so that these arrows are visible clearly and gives the information which we really want to convey. These are just few principles we should be careful about while doing our artwork. But as this was just an example, so I didn't paid much attention to the color and all. So by the way, this is all we are going to cover in today's video, and I hope you understand everything, and now I will see you in the next video. Goodbye.